Ok.
Così non
è interessante.
Sì, esatto.
Ciao. Io faccio un po' dare se è grande.
Penso che sia.
Today's guest is Enrico Terrone from the University of Barcelona, and the title of his talk is The Appreciator's Performance, Virtual Reality and Anthropology of Art. Thanks, Enrico.
Thank you, Elisa, and thank you also to the other organizer of this series of lectures in aesthetics for inviting me. So, this talk has two main objectives. The first one is to investigate the ontology of works of virtual reality. So it's a sort of new kind of work of art, one may say. And so it's interesting to investigate the ontological category to which these entities belong. So this will be the aim of the first part of my talk, and then I will try to exploit the result of this investigation on virtual reality to try to understand whether the ontological model that I think is good for explaining what's a virtual reality can also be used for other forms of art. And more generally, if this, what I will call the virtual reality paradigm, can be used to rethink the ontology of art, to propose a new account of the ontology of art in general. So it's much more ambitious, the second goal, whereas the first one is more localized. So the plan is to start with precisely with the ontology of virtual reality, then using the result of that to propose this ontological model for the investigation of the ontology of art that I will call the VR paradigm, and then try to extend this model, apply this model to other forms of art. So I will start from music and literature, then I will consider painting, and at the end I will try to propose a whole account of works of art in ontological terms, and more specifically what is called a monist ontology of art, that is an ontology of art that claims that all works of art belong to the same ontological category. So, first step, the ontology of virtual reality. So, an interesting example, maybe one of the first works of virtual reality that has been received and assessed as works of art is Carmen y Arena, that is a work by the Mexican filmmaker Alejandro González Iñárritu. So, this is a work that has been presented at the Cannes Film Festival as part of the official selection in 2017, but this work is not a film. So, in this sense, it's the first virtual reality project presented at the Cannes Festival. And so, the spectators of this work don't watch a moving picture on a screen as a film spectator normally do. Rather, they wear a special device and they live an experience of which should simulate the experience of immigrants at the border between Mexico and the United States. So, in spite of the context, which is a film festival, this object is different from the other works of art normally presented in this context. It's not a film, it's a work of virtual reality. So one may wonder whether at least this object belongs to the same ontological category to which film belongs. So even though it has different features, maybe at least the one reason why it's been presented in a film festival is that this work exhibit relevant ontological features in common with films, the same ontological structure. So what is a film? There is a debate about that, but there seems to be at least a standard view, a consensus view, and that's the claim that the films are types that can be instantiated by a two-step process. So the film as such is a type, understood as an abstract object, even though it's not abstract in an absolute sense. It's abstract of the kind of abstract object that can be created, so historically created abstract objects. But this object, in order to be appreciated, need some further steps. So there is, first of all, a concrete object that store, that embody the abstract object, and that's what is called the template. And then this template is used to produce an event, which is the screening of the film. So the overall structure is something like this. So there is a film as a type, and that's the object that we normally refer to when we say sentences like I like Terminator, or you know, White Strawberry is my favorite film. Normally when we discuss about the value of film, the meaning of films, we don't refer to particular screenings. We don't refer to particular film reels or digital files. We refer to an object that has not a location in space, and in this sense is abstract, even though it has a sort of location in time, in the sense that it started existing in a certain year when it has been created by the filmmaker. So the film as a type is the object that we refer to in conversation about film, is the object books in the history of film speak about. But then, in order to appreciate this object, we cannot directly appreciate an abstract object. So the object has to be embodied in an object that I call the template, and that's where one can draw the distinction between analog film and digital film. So in a traditional analog cinema, the template is a concrete object that is a film reel. And then this object can be used to produce the token that is the ultimate link of the chain that leads from the film as a work to the experience of the spectator. And the token is a screening, it's an event. In the digital cinema, the work remains the same, remains a type. The tokens of the type, the instantiation of the type, remains an event, which is a screening. The difference is that it is in the intermediate step. In this case, in digital cinema, we have a more complicated template, because the template is in turn an abstract object, in the sense that it's a series of digits, which is something abstract, and then this series of digits can be embodied in concrete objects like hard disk, DVDs, and things like that. But then, at the end, we still have the same final step, that is the template, the object that embodied the film as an abstract work, is used to produce an event, which is the screening. And by watching the screening, the spectator can appreciate and evaluate the film also as an abstract object, that is, as a type. So that's a basic sketch of the what one may call the standard view in the ontology of film. Can we apply the same model also to works of virtual reality? So in principle, when we say yes, works of virtual reality are types. In fact, they have multiple instances. A work like Carnegie Arena, there is not a place where I should go to see the Carnegie Arena. One can see Carnegie Arena in Milan, or in Venice, or in Cannes. So it can have multiple instances, so in this sense can be treated as a type. And also, this work has in common with films the fact that the type is embodied by templates, by objects, and these objects, just as in case of digital cinema, are computer files. So we have two levels that are in common between the ontology of film and the ontology of virtual reality. But then we have the last level, the token level, and so the question is, do we have also an analogy at this level? When we say yes, also also in the case of works of virtual reality, at the end you have a screening. In fact, when you, in order to enjoy a work of virtual reality, one should project the pictures on the glasses that are part of the headset that the appreciator uses. So there is a screening also in the case of virtual reality. So one might say the structure is exactly the same. So there is the work is an abstract object. It's embodied in a concrete object, which are computer files. And then this in ontology of art is called the templates. And then the templates are used to produce the token, which are screenings. But the problem is that a token is something that should show the relevant manifest features that the work specifies as a type. So a token should exhibit the feature specified by the type. So that is to say, the features that are relevant for the appreciation of the work. But in fact, the two screenings on the glasses do not directly exhibit the feature of the work. In fact, what one appreciates as the content of the work of virtual reality, as the relevant feature of the work of virtual reality, is a three-dimensional environment, not a couple of two-dimensional pictures on the two lenses of the glasses. So it seems that the screenings are relevant for the appreciation of the work, but are just as an intermediate step. So the two screenings, I go back to the previous one, so the two screenings are just an intermediate steps that are used basically by the brain, the mind, by the visual perceptual system of the appreciator to produce the real object of appreciation, the real object that instantiates the feature specified by the type. And this object is not the couple of pictures on the glasses, but it's rather what the subject perceives. So the headset screening, the screenings on the glasses, are not experienced as such by the viewer. This is another key point. Whereas in film, in watching a film, we are the screen, and therefore the screening is part of our perceptual experience. We can experience the people doing things, actors or characters, but we also experience the screen and the light on the screen, and we are aware of that. But in virtual reality, there is no perceptual awareness of the two pictures on the glasses. One can know that, one can be cognitively aware of that, but at the perceptual level, the screenings on the glasses are completely different from the screening on the screen in a movie theater. So in this sense, they are not relevant for the experience of the work, for the appreciation of the work. They are just an intermediate step, just as the one is not aware one is not perceptually aware of the fact that there is a computer, that there is a code, or in all the analog cinema, the spectator should not be aware and is not perceptually aware of the fact that there is a film reel, a projector. The only object the spectator is perceptually aware in traditional cinema is the screen. And in the case of virtual reality, even the screen is out of the perceptual scope of the appreciator's experience. So it seems that the The screening is not a good candidate for the role of the token in the ontological structure that constitute a work of virtual reality as a work of art. So, which alternative? Since that the experience itself of the spectator seems to be a better alternative as a token, since it's what shows the relevant features of the work is not something that is somewhere in space, not some patterns of color on the lenses. It's rather a sort of perceptual object, mental object, that is the outcome of the coupling of the screenings on the glasses with the perceptual system of the appreciator. So in this sense, one can treat the appreciator herself as a performer who produced the token of the work of virtual reality, just as a piano player produces the token of a sonata by playing the piano. So in this sense, it seems that it's the appreciator herself who contributes to the production of the token. Instead of just enjoying the token of the work, the appreciator contributes by means of her experience to the production of the token of the work, that is, the production of the object that exhibits the relevant feature of the work as a type. So, yeah, to use a slogan, it's a sort of variant of Putnam's same slogan. So in this case, the token is not in the headset, it's rather in the head. It's part of the, it's a part of the experience of the spectator. It's not an object that you can find in the external space. So in this sense, the analogy between the ontology of things and the ontology of work of virtual reality, VR works for short, is only at two stages. So both, they are both types, they both have templates, but the token is different. In the case of films, the token is a screening, whereas in the case of virtual reality, the token is a sort of experience or the outcome of a mental process. So yeah, in the case of film, I may say it's a light event, whereas in the case of a virtual reality, it's rather a mental event that is an experience. So we have a schema like that. In the case of virtual reality, the work is a type, the template with the double level typical of digital templates. Then the template is used to produce a screening. But the screening is not the token because it doesn't exhibit the relevant feature. So it's just another level, another object that allows for the production of tokens. So one may call this a secondary template. And then the secondary template coupled with the brain of the appreciator can be used to produce the true token, the true object that exhibits the relevant feature of the work, namely the appreciator's performance. So far, I defended the claim that the ontology of film and the ontology of virtual reality are different. At least they are different at the level of the tokens. So they involve different kinds of tokens. Now I would like to explore a different possibility. That is, so one, this may be called a divisive account, since it divides the ontology of film from the ontology of virtual reality. I've already shown that an attempt to unify the two ontologies by creating the tokens as screenings fail because the screening in the case of virtual reality do not show the relevant feature of the work. So one may not treat the screening as tokens. But what I would like to do now is the, try to go the other way around. So say, yeah, you cannot treat the screening in the case of virtual reality as tokens. But maybe you can treat, also in the case of film, the experience of the spectator as a token. So the idea is that also in the case of film, the true object of appreciation is not just light on the screen. It's not just patterns of light on the screen. What's relevant for the appreciation of a film, the relevant feature that constitute a film as a type, the features that are specified by a film as a type, are rather three-dimensional scenes, and there is a key feature of that, which is the impression of movement. But the impression of movement is not something that is as such on the screen, it's rather an effect that is produced by the interaction between the patterns of light on the screen and the human perceptual system. So once again, what's relevant for the appreciation, what's correspond to the feature specified by the type, is not just the pattern of light on the screen. The pattern of light on the screen is just an input that is processed by the human perceptual system in order to produce the true object of appreciation, which is once again an experience. So, along this line of reasoning, one might unify film and virtual reality not by trying to try to bring virtual reality back to cinema, but rather the other way around. So, trying to rethink the ontology of film by using the paradigm of virtual reality. And so, in this sense, the ontology of film can be reconsidered in the following way. So, we still have the film as a type. We still have the possibility to have two different kinds of templates, either the analog template, the film reel, or the digital template, the file that is embodied by hard disk or DVD or Blu-ray. Then there is the screening, and that's all. As before, but now the idea that comes from the paradigm of virtual reality is that the screening is not the token, it's just a secondary template, it's just something that supports the production of the token. The true token is the moving, the scene that involves an impression of movement that is produced by coupling the human perceptual system with the screening. So once again, it's the associator performance. So from this perspective, we have a unified model in the sense that both the type and the token are the same in the two cases. So we have both in virtual reality and film, the type is an abstract object, and both in virtual reality and film, the token is an experience. The difference is only in the intermediate steps, so in the way in which we go from the abstract object to the token as an experience. And this difference involves the fact that in the case of film, we have one screening for all the spectators of a certain event, or in a certain movie theater. Whereas in the case of virtual reality, there is one screening for each spectator. But it's just a difference in the intermediate steps. The two basic elements in this ontological model are the type of the token and the token, and the type of the token are of the same kind both for film and virtual reality. An interesting case in this respect is the case of three-dimensional films, 3D films. There are many, both art house films like Jean-Luc Godard, Adieu Langage, or blockbuster like Avatar. So, why this is an intermediate case? Because just in two-dimensional film, there is one screening for all the spectators, and the screening, even in 3D film, is an object of experience. We are perceptually aware of the screen while watching a three-dimensional film. And that's the difference with respect to virtual reality, in which there is no perceptual awareness of the screening on the glasses. On the other hand, 3D cinema is similar to virtual reality, since the spectator, in order to produce the appropriate object of appreciation, need a technical device, namely special glasses. So just watching is not sufficient, unlike what happens in traditional cinema, and both 3D cinema and virtual reality are based on stereoscopy, and stereoscopy require this technical device, the headset or special glasses. So, in fact, it's in the case of 3D cinema, it's rather clear that the screening cannot be the token, because it lacks the relevant features of the work. If one just watches the screen, there are just two slightly superimposed pictures, but this is not what the filmmaker has mandated us to see, to experience. So what is the object that show the relevant feature in the case of a 3D cinema is what we produce by putting on glasses and applying our perceptual system to these two pictures on the screen. So in the case of 3D film, once again, the ontological model is the one that we have seen in the case of virtual reality. So the type, templates, the templates are used to produce the screening, but the screening is not enough. In order to have the token, in order to have something that shows the relevant feature of the work, we need to couple the screening with the human perceptual system. So in this sense, the token is not the screening itself, it's rather the experience of the appreciator. So the idea is that we can have a unified ontological model for all these works, and the difference can be explained just by considering the process by means of which the tokens are produced, starting from the type. So in the case of virtual reality, the tokens are produced by means of screening on special glasses. In the case of 3D cinema, screening and special glasses, and that's different because the screening in this case is something that we can perceive, so it's part of the experience, even though it's not there is more in the experience than the experience of the screening. And finally, the case of traditional cinema, there is no need for special glasses, and there is just the screening. But also in this case, the screening is not enough, because in order to have the relevant object of appreciation with its peculiar impression of movement, this screening should be processed by the appreciator perceptual system. So, that's basically the idea of unifying these three forms of art, the cinema, traditional cinema, and virtual reality. So just to sum up, it seems that it's tempting in the case of traditional cinema to say, yeah, the screening is enough, you can just watch it, so the token is the screening, you just have to watch it, so all you need is there. But the fact that it's we don't need a technical device, we don't need special glasses to produce the tokens, does not entail that we don't contribute by means of our processor system to produce the token. We do so, in fact, because what there is on the screen is just a series of pictures, 24 pictures per second, whereas the object of appreciation is rather a continuous experience of object moving. Then, in the case of 3D cinema, there is a more complex mediation made by the special glasses. The screening as a template remains perceptible, but it's clearly not enough, because there are just two superimposed pictures. And then the limit case is virtual reality, in which the screening is no longer perceptible. And all we have at the level of experience is what is produced by the experience itself by processing the input coming from the screening on the special glasses. So that's the idea of this first part of the talk. So the idea that we can have a unified ontological model for film and virtual reality, provided that we accept to consider as token of films, not the screenings, but the result of the processing of the screening by the spectator. So, what I call the VR paradigm is precisely this idea that the token of at least certain works of art are not physical objects, but rather mental object, but object produced by the human mind by processing information coming from physical objects. Another interesting case in this respect is the case of video games, but it's not much literature in philosophical aesthetics on that, but a sort of presupposed ontological idea seems to be that the token of video games are just like the token of film in the standard account, namely screenings. But in the case of video games, it seems clear that if a token is something that should exhibit the relevant feature of the world, the screening is not enough. Otherwise, to appreciate a video game, one should just watch somebody else playing, whereas it seems to be something rather accepted in the studies on video games, that in order to appreciate, to evaluate a video game, you should play it, not just watching somebody else play. So it seems that the actions of the player, and therefore the experience of the player, is something constitutive of the instantiation of the world. So the token of a video game should also include the actions of the player. And so, also in the case of video games, we share with virtual reality the feature of interactivity. So both in the case of video games and virtual reality, the appreciator can also do something and change the content of the world, unlike what happens in the case of films. And so, in these cases, the performance seems to be something crucial in the token. So the token cannot just be a screen, because also what the appreciator do is part of the relevant features of the work. So, once again, we can use the VR paradigm, this ontological structure that goes from the type as an abstract object to the token as a performance or experience of a subject through a chain which is made by templates, which in this case also just in virtual reality and digital cinema are computer files, then produce screening, and then the screening produce the token. So the key idea remains that the screening are not the tokens, they are just means to the end of producing the token. But the tokens are not screenings, the tokens are experiences or performances. In fact, I go directly to the last line, since I just said that. I'm using experiences and performances almost as synonymous, in the sense that I trade these two terms as a reference to the same thing in two different ways. So, when I say performance, I'm focusing more on what the appreciator does. If I use experience, I'm focusing more on what the appreciator feels. But the idea is that there is a mental event that is crucial for the appreciation of work of art. This event can involve agency and surely involve perception. And one can characterize this mental event both as performance or as experience. So, to sum up the virtual reality paradigm, the idea is that worlds are types, their tokens should not be identified with screenings or audiovisual patterns, because there is more in the work, in fact. What the work specifies as a type, one may say, is a use plan that exploits the visual pattern, but does not boil down to the visual part, to the audiovisual pattern themselves. It's something that can be found in the debate about the ontology of technical artifacts, the idea that what makes an artifact what it is, it's not just its structure, but it's also what one can do with this artifact. So what's this notion of use plan. And so it's, if we trade the work, these works of art, like film or work of virtuality, as types, we can say that in the types, in the constitutive feature of the work, there are not there is not just a structure, but there is also a sort of use plan, user manual, a sort of prescription of what one should do with this visual structure. And therefore, if the type is that, if the type is a visual structure plus prescription, specifying how to use the visual structure, the audiovisual structure, then the token cannot be just the manifestation of the visual structure, namely the screening. The token should include also an instantiation of the use plan itself, and therefore this instantiation of the use plan should be the appreciator performance. Another way of expressing this idea is by using Walton's approach in the philosophy of representational art. And so, in this case, Walton has this idea of works as props in games of make-believe. But precisely for him, the work is not just the prop, it's also the game. And so, if we use this in combination with the type token model, to instantiate a work is not just to produce an instance of the prop, of the tool that allows one to play the game of make-believe. It's rather to produce also an instance of the use of this prop. And that's once again the idea that the token should be not just a token of the prop, but a token of the game, and therefore the appreciator performance. So that's the paradigm, the conception of a work of art that can be extracted from the case of virtual reality. Now, in the second conclusive part of the talk, I'm trying to generalize this VR model, the VR paradigm, as much as possible. So, the idea is that in the case of virtual reality, this seems to be rather compelling. This seems to me to be the only or at least the most effective way of conceiving an ontology of works of virtual reality. But the idea is that also for other more traditional form of art, the same paradigm can be used. It's just more difficult to see why it's worthwhile to use this paradigm also for literature, painting, and music. But we can do so. At least that's what I would like to argue. So it's the idea that technology reveals the essence, or when there is strong technological mediation, like in virtual reality, it's easier to see the ontological structure, but even where technology is not crucial or is completely absent, we can use what we have learned by means of technological arts to better understand also more traditional forms of art. So I start with music and the literature because they share at least the type token structure. So there is a commonality with the technological forms of art considered so far, virtual reality, video games, films, in the sense that all of these cases, at least in the standard accounts, in the ontology of art, the idea is that the best ontological model to account for these works of art is the time token model. So in the case of music, the standard account is that defended, for instance, by Nicholas Walterstorff, Julian Dodd, Jerry Levinson. The idea is that works of fractal types, so abstract object that specifies auditory features. Then these types are embodied by concrete objects like scores, and then which play the role of templates. And then these templates are used to produce the relevant object of appreciation, which exhibit the features specified by the types, namely the tokens, which in the case of music are the performance of the musicians. But if we apply the VR paradigm to works of music, we can say that also the performance of the musicians, so the sounds as physical entities in the that we can listen, are not the relevant objects of appreciation. What we really appreciate in listening to works of music is rather the product of the interaction of the sounds as physical object and our perceptual system. So it's what Roger Scruton calls sounds as secondary objects and pure events. So it's the idea that sounds are, Scruton compared them to rainbows. So object that we construct by means of our minds by taking physical objects and as input, but the object, the relevant object in this case is a sensory object, and sounds can be treated in this way, and therefore also in this case the idea is that the token of a work of music is produced by the listener. So it's the sound as a secondary object that is not in space, but rather in the mind of the of the of the listener. So to sum up, it's, there is the work as a creation. There are templates, but each template can be used to produce a series of performances. The standard account is the performance, is the token, whereas if we apply the virtual reality paradigm, the performance is just a secondary template that allows each listener to produce its own token, which is the sound as the product of the interaction between the auditory system and the physical sound produced by the performance. In the case of literature, the ontology the ontology of music is very similar to that of film and works of virtual reality. We have the type, template, token, model, even in the standard account. The case of literature is a bit different because the idea is that in the case of literature, the token and the template are the same thing. So there is the type, the abstract object, a certain novel created during a certain year by a certain writer. Then this type is used to produce templates, which are the paper copies of the book. But then there is no need for a screening or a performance by an orchestra. The token is the copy itself. That's the standard account in the ontology of literature. So, the template is already the token. You just have to watch the book, to read the book, and that's enough to appreciate a work of literature. So it's a bit different with respect to the cases we have considered so far, because the template and the token collapse, so to say. But once again, one may say that a book understood as inks, marks on pieces of paper is not something that exhibits the relevant feature of the work as a type. In fact, the work of literature as a type specifies not only characters but also semantic features, basically. And that's something that, in order to be produced, requires once again the coupling of a cognitive system with this object. So it seems that the relevant feature of a work of literature are not just marks of ink on pieces of paper, it's rather what is produced when these marks of ink meet a cognitive system that is capable of understanding their meaning. And so, if we apply the VR model to literature, the idea is that we have the work as a type that's in common with the standard model, the creation of the writer. Then this can be used to produce a series of templates, which are the copies, the different copies of the book. But for the standard model, that's all for the ontology of literature. So each copy is a token of the work, and that's finished. My idea is that each token is just a tool that we can use to produce token. But the real token, what exhibits the feature, the relevant feature of the work, is not the book as such, is the experience that one does in reading the book. So each book can be used as a sort of a template by means of which every reader can produce its own token by means of its own performance. So the reader becomes a sort of player who instantiate the book by reading it, just as a musician instantiate a sonata by playing it. And this is an idea that can be found not in ontology of art, in philosophical aesthetics, but rather in literary theories. For instance, it's an idea that has been defended by Umberto Eco, by Richard Garrick. It's the idea that the reader basically is a performer. Reading a book is doing something, it's something that can be compared to playing a game or playing music. And if we read this from an ontological perspective, the consequence should be that the true instance of a work of literature is produced by the reader. It's not just the book, it's what one can do with the book. So, very briefly, a further extension of the VR paradigm is painting. Painting is a more complicated case because it's completely outside the type token model in the standard account in the ontology of art. So the common idea is that novels, works of music, films are types that can be instantiated by tokens. So they are not objects that have a unique location in space and times. Rather, there are types that can be instantiated in different places and different times, or even in different places at the same time. By contrast, the idea of the paintings that there are particular, so if you want to see the Mona Lisa, you should go to the Louvre. There are no instances of Mona Lisa in different places. There are photographs, but these are not considered instances. They are just copies. And so the painting is considered not a type, but a particular. That's the standard account. So, my point is that if we apply the VR model, we can say, yes, of course, the Mona Lisa cannot be reproduced. It's a unique object. I can agree with that. Nevertheless, if the token is the experience of the appreciator, then we can use this unique object as a template to produce different tokens. Basically, each viewer who look at the Mona Lisa has a, what Wolheim's call a seeing experience. So it basically use this colored surface to produce an experience which also involves a three-dimensional scene. And it's this experience that instantiates the relevant features of the painting, not just the marks of the colored marks on the surface. So what is unique, according to the paradigm I propose, is not the work, it's just the template. So Mona Lisa, more generally, a painting, is a work that has just one template, just one object that embodied it, but by means of this template, several instances can be produced because the instance, the token, what shows the relevant feature of the work is not the surface, is the experience that a viewer can do by using this surface. So So there can be several experiences at the same time, and therefore there can be several tokens, and therefore the ontological structure is a type token structure. Basically, this structure. So the work is a creation, it's embodied in a template, but the template can be used in order to produce the different experience. The experience counts as token because they show the relevant feature of the work, and therefore there are different tokens, and therefore the ontological structure is a type token structure. The difference with respect to music, literature, and film is just that the template cannot be reproduced. Okay, so that's just a repetition of what I said. I can skip that one and go to the conclusion. So, what I would like to propose is that we can extend this model not only to the forms of art that I've discussed so far, but to all forms of art, to any form of art. And in this way, we should have what is called a monist ontology, that is an ontology of art that claims that all works of art belong to the same ontological category. And in my case, the ontological category is the type token category. Which are the explanatory advantages of a type token, of a monist ontology in general? It's simpler, it's more elegant, and it also has a great advantage for what concerns another great problem in the philosophy of art, which is the definition of art. Because if you have a monist ontology, then the definition of art is just, you are already part of the job that has been done, because you have the categories. You just have to find a specific difference that distinguish all the works of art from other things that can be within the same category. But at least you have a domain that within which you can look for the specificity of works of art. Whereas if you have a pluralist ontology, you, for the definition, you have to start from scratch. And so it helps because you have part of the definition is already done in the sense that you have found some essential features of work of art, their ontological structure, and you just have to add something to that. So what I propose to say is a type token monist ontology, so the idea that all works of art belong to the same category, and this category is the type token category. And so at the end, I would like to just briefly compare my proposal to the two main ontology of art that are monist and that use the type token model that can be found in the debate. One has been proposed by Peter Strawson and the other by Greg Carr. So Strawson's idea is that all works of art are individuals and they are types and not particulars. And then he understands types as a general rule for the production of particular instances. But Strawson remains attached to the, endorses the idea that the tokens are physical objects. And so in order to defend the claim that also paintings are types, he tried to use arguments in order to show that paintings cannot be reproduced in our age because of technical limitation, but in principle we can have a more sophisticated technology that can reproduce painting, and in this way we can treat paintings as types. So ontologically they are types, it's just a contingent matter that we treat them as particular because we lack technology that allows us to reproduce them. So my account is not committed to that. So I think this is an advantage. Even though Strawson is wrong on that, if he's wrong on that, he should give up his monist account. But even if this work paintings cannot be reproduced not only for contingent reason but for essential reason, I can keep treating them as types. For me, the tokens are not the particular objects, but are the experiences. So that's it's an advantage. Furthermore, I think that Strauss's account has further problems because it's not just paintings. There are works which are unique for different reasons. For instance, performances that are considered to be unique in the sense that the work is only a particular event. So if you cannot attend this event, you cannot appreciate the work. And the event is such, it's not something that can be reproduced, at least it seems to me. For instance, the Korn concert by Keith Jarrett is considered something that is the concert itself that is a work of art. So a recording of the concert, even a video recording of the conference is not enough to appreciate the work. In order to appreciate the work, you must be there. And in Strauss's view, you cannot trade this as a type token entity. By contrast, in my account, you can do that. Because if the token is the appreciated performance, of course you have constraints, you must be there. But when you are there, there are many spectators there. Each spectator produces its own instances of the work, and so the type token structure is preserved. And yeah, a variant of that is a point that has been made by Sherry Irvin, is the idea that it's part of the creativity, of the freedom of the artist, to establish the ontological category of her work. So, as Irvin puts it, the works of art can be intended by their makers to be particular animal types. For instance, Kejari may say, my work is this performance, and not just a recording of this performance, it's not that. In conceptual art, Irvin make an example from conceptual art. I have another example, it's Tullus Fischer wax sculpture. So in this case, the work is the wax, and you should attend this particular event of the wax that is dissolved by the fire. And in this case, it's a Strauss has big problem. Whereas my account, I think, has no problem because even if there is one unique physical object, there are still a multiplicity of experiences, and if the token is the experience, you still have the type token structure. Skip this one.
I mean, go ahead if you'd like, you have like 10 minutes if you prefer.
Yeah, no, even less, just a couple, just to present the other account. And just so the Greg Carey account is has not the problem that Strauss has, because for him, works of art are types in the sense that they are action types. So there are patterns of actions that are followed by the artist in order to produce a particular object, which according to Carey is just part of the work. So the work is a series of actions that ends up in a structure. And therefore, in this case, he has no problem with all the cases we have considered so far. Even in the case of painting, for him, the ontological nature of the painting is a series of action that ends up in this particular visual structure, which is the painting. So then when I say, yeah, the visual structure can be instantiated only by one concrete object, but it's not a problem because the work is not the visual structure, it's the series of action that leads to the visual structure. In this case, the problem is that, as has been pointed out by Julian Dodd, the work cannot be appreciated. Because when we watch a painting, we cannot experience the action of the painter. So the main problem of Carey's account is that if the work is an action type, when we experience the work, we are not experiencing all the relevant features of the work. And this seems to be strange, to have works that have features, but when we experience the work, we cannot experience this feature. And so, last slide. So I think that this Carey's is on the right way. Just my proposal is just to substitute action with experience. So works are not action type, they are experience type, so and we can fully experience them by instantiating them by means of experience tokens. That's all. Thank you.
So we need to use the iPad as a microphone, otherwise other people won't hear our questions. It's a bit tricky.
Okay. Hi, thanks. Okay, very interesting. Thank you. I'm guessing whether you know you are using token in the same way as everybody, nearly everybody else, does, in the sense that what token, what is all about the type token distinction is about repeatability. And the general idea seems to be that there are a set of properties of the type which are encoded by any good token of it. And they are, in a sense, differential in character. That is, the general idea is structuralist in principle, but it doesn't matter. And the idea is that, a token preserves all the features of the type that are relevant within a certain appreciation system or within a certain linguistic system. So the idea is that, a word type has some features that is being made by letter types, which are different one from another in a certain way. And this kind of difference ought to be preserved in any token. So it seems to me that you pointed to a very different relation, which is, for instance, the relation between the game of chess and the specific game, okay, so a specific performer of chess, which also has a type token distinction. It is the area you can see, you can have a game type, and different concrete games can be tokens of that game type. But with
matches.
A specific match, specific match. So we often repeat a given match because it was especially pleasant from an aesthetic viewpoint, and so we have different tokens of a specific chess game with specific chess match. And these are what I would call a token. And it has to do with the fact that a certain thing can be repeated more or less with the same relevant properties here and there. Of course, you never have a complete and perfect repetition. All that matters is that a set of properties which allow you to, you know, define an equivalent class is given within every token. So what strikes me as very different situation is that of virtual reality, your pictures, or video games, if you want, in which there are completely and dramatic differences between single performances. That is, think of a video game match. These are more or less the same relation which are there between, which is there between two football matches. It is. They are, of course, in a way, they are performances of the same game, but they are not token of football. That is, football does not admit for a type token reasonable distinction. There is not even the linguistic ambiguity which you have. That is, what is characteristic of the type token distinction is because of this repeatability, you have linguistic ambiguity. So we say a book and we mean either a copy or and so on. And you don't have it with game performances, a kind of distinction which I was pointing out. And you don't have it even in the case of video games. That if you can say, okay, I played, Pac-Man, but this does not mean that you're referring to, you're generally referring to the game Pac-Man, and if you want to refer to a single match, you're not, you don't have this kind of ambiguity which you have between type and token. So it seems to me very, very different from the case, the ordinary case of type token as we usually conceive it. So I would urge that you or other people at least say that you are using token in a very broad and maybe very different way, otherwise it is difficult to connect. And I would have something else to say that was
not. There is, I'm told, a related question, so perhaps we can Okay, bring them together.
It's probably more convenient for you because it's probably just a variation on this question. Thanks for the talk, by the way. I really, really enjoyed it. So, if you identify a type with the collection of all its tokens, and maybe you don't, but say you do, then my impression is that in your case, given that the tokens are so dissimilar, because you consider the token something like an order pair composed by the template and an experience, and the experience can be very different. So if you think about the tokens in this way, the class of the token is going to be very unnatural in the sense of David Lewis, meaning that the elements of the class are going to be very dissimilar between each other. And this is not meant as a knockdown objection or anything, or not even as an objection, but I mean, I just wanted to point out this and see your reaction. You see what I mean. So if the tokens are just the templates, they are going to be more or less similar. But anyway, if you add a further element, then of course the tokens are going to be more dissimilar than they used to be. And the tokens are going to be more dissimilar than, for instance, between each other than in Strawson's account. And so the class is going to be the class of the tokens that is on certain account, the type is going to be less natural.
May I answer? Of course. Okay. Thanks for the questions. So, first question. Since that the difference is in the verb, in the sense that we are both interested in the fact that the token should be related to the relevant features of the type, but you say that what for you the token is something that preserves the relevant feature of the type. Whereas for me, what's crucial is that the token exhibit the relevant feature of the type. So, because if you just want to preserve this in the ontology of art, you have this distinction between token and template. But if you just want the preservation, you have no longer distinction between token and template, because also the template preserves the relevant feature of the type, but it doesn't exhibit that. If a film reel, we can use film, which is maybe a more typical case. A film reel preserves the relevant feature of the type. You can also watch each frame of the film, but the film reel doesn't exhibit the relevant feature of the type, because the film as a type, as an object, as a work of art, as an object of appreciation, as feature that cannot be scrutinized just by watching at the template. So the token in this debate should have something more than just the preservation of the feature, should also have the exhibition of the feature. And that's why people say that the score in music is just a template, whereas the performance by the musicians is a token. My point is that if you really want that, at least in the case of virtual reality, the screening is not enough. So the same problem that you have for the template, for the digital file, you still have them with the screening, because at least in the case of virtual reality, the relevant features are not there in the glasses. So if you want this notion, this is the notion of talking used in the ontology of art. Otherwise, you just have the template.
Just saying that coming from a different area of thought, I just
can't get how you can consider a screening, that the screenings that are wholly different one from another. This one maybe is totally black because the guy has been watching downstairs, and downstairs there's only black, and others are completely different one from another. These things could be considered the screening themselves. That is, my criticism is not about your mental turn within respect to this kind of idea of the screening as token, but the very idea of screenings as token. That's because they clearly Well, you can see exhibiting is something more than preserving, perhaps, I don't know, but of course screenings does not preserve the relevant properties of the world, that is, a virtual reality. Oh, sorry, I'm not speaking about movies, I'm speaking about virtual reality, of course. Otherwise, of course, screenings are good example of tokens in the... Okay, for screenings there, you have a massive loss of information, a massive loss of information with respect to the work itself. That is, the work itself has a word then inside, and that's only a small piece of a word seen from a specific perspective. You know, I don't know, but I think you're getting what I'm saying. That is, so there's much more information in the VR work encoded going on, which allows everybody to appreciate something from their own perspective than each perspective. In a way, there's something similar with the score of musical score as played by a single player within an orchestra. You know, single player play one, only one piece of the score. And that's something closer in an analogy to screenings or to performances, as you can see there, much more than tokens. That is, a single player playing violin within an orchestra is not producing a token, producing something different. And I can see strongly this analogy with the case of appreciators' performance in a WR, in a VR world. Sorry. Hope this clarified my point.
Yeah, it's not clear to me where this leads. So it's your idea that in the case of virtual reality, simply there are no tokens, or the token is just a digital file, and then or the token is all this thing together. So the experience, the screening. So which is the alternative? In fact, is in your view?
I would say only this one. My idea is, I'm not very fond of the type token distinction. I don't think that it applies to every field of human inquiry. But screenings that are dramatically different one with another, and anyway capture only a fragment of the information encoded by the VR work, in my mind, sound like strange things to be called tokens of the type. It seems to me much closer, much more similar to the case of the single score player, which only get a fragment of the whole world.
Okay, you can get all the fragment and you have the token. So you have this. Yeah.
The problem is that. I agree. I would say that the type can only be extracted by any possible screening, in a way, in this sense. If you're asking to me to go the whole stride with my analogy, but if you accept my analogy, the idea would be, the type corresponds to a host of partial tokens, and maybe the world token is only given by the sum of all possible screenings. So that would be where my analogy leads, but I am not too fond of my analogy.
Okay, just last short point is that it's important. I didn't say that, but I should have done it. Is that normally it's considered this notion of type token in ontology of art is considered a normative notion. So the type is normative for the token, so you can have bad tokens. So the token should exhibit the relevant feature of the file, all the relevant features of the type, but you can have, in this case it's called a correct token, but you can also have incorrect tokens. So in music, the type specified certain auditory features, but one can have a bad performance of Beethoven Fifth Symphony. Nevertheless, this is still a performance of Beethoven Fifth Symphony. So you don't, in order to have a token in the ontology of art, you don't need to exactly have all the features. You should have that, but if you just have enough of them, you have, you say, yeah, it's not a great performance, but nevertheless, it's a performance, and so it's a token.
Yeah, yeah. But this is also in other areas, say, what Kaplan has to say, but I think even Peirce, of course, there are bad tokens, and they are tokens, nonetheless, because of something intentional.
Matteo, it's yeah. So no, in the ontology of art, there is a problem with this idea that the type is the collection of the token, because you cannot appreciate the idea is that you should have a type that can be appreciated through the token. Whereas if it's a collection, it changes. So it seems that you are not appreciating the work when you are listening to a symphony. You are not really appreciating a symphony. This is normally considered a flaw for Goodman ontology of music, which is based on this idea. Because one constraint which is normally accepted in this debate, and yeah, but even if in this case it's I'm not sure whether there is, even if you accept that the type is a collection of the tokens, if I have a problem there, because you say they are very different, in the sense the experience are very different, but even performances in music can be very different. So you can have a performance of Bach by Glenn Gould, on the clavicembalo, you can have the same performance on a piano, you can have performance by a computer. So the maybe connected to this idea that the type is just normative. So a token is not just something that has all the features specified by the type, but it's just something that abides by this prescription in some way. So it seems that diversity is not a problem, provided that there is a common factor that is trying to follow the prescription. So yeah, in the case of experience, you have more diversity, maybe because everybody has his own experience. But the work is that it's a prescription, and so it's part of. In fact, it's also the case of games. In fact, video games there are games like football, but we don't appreciate football as an object, as a work of art. Whereas we appreciate certain video games, maybe not Pac-Man, but other video games are considered as work of art. And in this case, one evaluate the analogous of football, that is the game, and the only way to do that is playing. And so since that the object that one is considering as the mediation towards the evaluation of the video game is precisely its act of playing.
Yes, yes, but my point was really not terribly deep. That is, it was just I would not equate the game performance relation to the type token one. There's much more probably involved in the type token. There are much more constraints on token than are on performance of the game. So probably just a terminological point, and due to the fact that I'm not very immersed in the aesthetic use of the term token.
Okay, thanks. You need to add something?
No.
Okay. Are there other questions from
here?
Okay.
Just two clarification questions. First one concerns this late debate. It seems to me that one way to solve it could be to try to reintroduce something similar to the distinction between autographic and allographic art, where you have a principal computation or where you don't have it. And it seems to me that going in this direction, probably you can have some way to specify this normative aspect of the tokens type of distinction and say something where this normative aspects are not at work. And I was just wondering what you think about it. That's the first question. My second question concerns the use guide. In Vermaase, Uke's paper, this is just the manual guide. You use it as an analogy. I was just wondering how we can push this analogy, because we talk about technical artifact, and we say that when you want to know what function this artifact is, you have to take this user guide and you have to use it in order to specify the function. How can we go in this direction in order to specify what, let's say, the screening and something like that could be?
So, I'm not sure whether, maybe I didn't understand well, but I'm not sure whether the Goodman orthographic allographic distinction may be useful, because it's orthogonal to the type token distinction, in the sense that you can have, for instance, in Goodman view, it doesn't speak about that, but it seems rather clear that at least analog films for him are orthographic, because there is no notation. It's not notational. So for him, the criterion between for the distinction between orthographic and allographic is the possibility of having a notation and in films. But you still have multiple instances. So in fact, Goodman himself, he has this distinction between one stage, two stage forms of art, which say it's orthogonal to the allographic autographic distinction. And it seems to me that the relevant distinction here is rather one stage, two stage, rather than autographic allographic. Of course, if it's, if a form of art is allographic, then it has a sort of type token ontology, because the notation makes room for multiple instances. But so it seems to be sufficient, but it's not necessary, because there can be form of art in which you can have multiple instances without a notation, by means of just a causal mechanism, like in an analog film or photographs. Photographs are non-notational, at least analog photographs, but you have a technology that allows you to produce a variety of tokens of the same photograph. So it seems to me that it may be, I think it's very helpful for the distinction between the, that one. So if you want a distinction between analog template and digital, analog cinema and digital cinema, or analog photography and digital photography, then maybe the notion of notation and allography can be helpful. There are some papers, John Steinbeck has an interesting paper about that. I also wrote something about that. So I think it's good for distinguishing between analog cinema and digital cinema. But cinema, for me, remains a form of art that has a type token ontology, regardless of whether it's being analog or digital, and so regardless of the orthographic allographic distinction. Second question: the user guide or use plan. That's I try to explain a bit better what I would like to do with that, but it's very speculative. My idea is that what I like in this account is that it seems that the identity of the artifact is not just the structure, is the use plan that embeds the structure. So the identity of a pen is not just having this piece connected together, having ink, is that plus sort of prescription, you should do that with the function of writing. So my idea is that if you apply the same model to works of art that are types, like works of virtual reality, so in the type you have both things, you have a structure that can correspond to the screening, the sounds, and then you have the prescription, you should use the structure in order to perceive in a certain way, to move, to simulate. And therefore, if the structure is that at the type level, the token of that should be not just an instantiation of the structure, but also an instantiation of the use plan. So that's my idea. If the identity condition is specified at the type level by the structure plus the use plan, then the instantiation of this object should be not only an instantiation of the structure, namely a screening, but also an instantiation of the use plan, namely the appreciator performance. Do you think it makes sense?
Yeah.
Other questions? I have a couple of questions, if that's okay. So one is a rather minor point. I'll start from that, and then I'll go with the other issue, which is more of a commentary, actually. When you sum up Strawson's account, I think you are perhaps being a bit too harsh with Strawson for this reason. You, as Shari Irving, too, you say, well, Strawson has a problem because it's important that we preserve this intuition that artists can decide what counts as an instance of a work that has multiple instances. Mm? And Strawson's account does not allow to do that. And I think we don't need to commit ourselves to the claim that artists can decide what counts as a token of a certain work. What artists can decide is what counts as an original instantiation of a certain work. What kind of objects have the relevant historical properties that make them original instances? Mm. But this doesn't mean that in principle works, all kinds of works of art, the paintings thereby included, can have multiple instances, only that some of such instances cannot count as original, historically appropriate ones. So, in my view, certain historical properties are not part of the definition of what makes a token of a certain artwork. I think this is an account that can be defended and that can vindicate views such as Strawson's. So this is the minor point. Yeah, of course.
When you say original instances is the same as correct instance, so it's the best way to the perfect way to, or you mean original only in the sense of the first one?
In the historic, it is it has a normative value that instances that are not original don't have, because original instances are the ones that manifest the properties that an instance of the work needs to have in order to count as an instance of that work.
So how can the other instance be instance if they don't have these properties?
Because I would like to distinguish between what makes an instance of a certain object, and what makes a certain physical object have a certain kind of normative value, which is something that does not have to do with it being an instance, but with it being used in a certain way due to certain historical conditions that apply.
Okay, I try to... if you say it's something similar, because it's the only way in which I can understand that, but it's my limit. So I would say, in your view, the original one, say Keith Jarrett's concert, he say, I intend that the only work is that one. If you want to attend to this work, you should come to Köln in this date. Otherwise, you just have postcards or. But you say, no, in fact, you, K. Jarrett, you don't have the right to do that. You can just say, this is the best way to enjoy my work, is to come to Köln at this date. But then the other are just less good instances, but they are still in. So a recording of this concert is still an instance. It's not. It's just as a I don't know, a performance of Beethoven symphony. You can have a great orchestra, or you can have a performance of Beethoven symphony made by a computer, by a synthesizer on a computer. So it's less good as a performance, but it remains a performance. So say if it's not completely compliant with this specification by the artist. Maybe it's not a right performance, it's not a correct performance, it's not a performance that has all the relevant features because it lacks a causal feature, a relational features, but still has some relevant features. The sounds are the same, and therefore, why not say that it's a recording of this concert that can count as performance? Is that your point?
So I would not apply it to recordings of performances. Let's take the Keith Jarrett example. To me, a good equivalent would be a performance that we have good reasons to claim is done in the same way in which Keith Jarrett performed different concert. And in for purely technical reasons, it might be impossible for us to achieve this kind of reproduction of a performance that might be, for technical reasons, a particularly difficult example, having to do with the improvisation of character of the performance and so forth and so on. But that's a purely contingent issue.
Okay.
So that is my view.
Yeah, it's maybe.
Yeah. It's a copy. Yeah.
Yeah. Since at least one can individuate some cases, I don't know, I may say just a sort of experiment, a performer, an artist who do something during an event, a ceremony, and this event is unique, his performance is unique because it's something connected to this event, I don't know, a performance during the first speech of some president. And this is something that this can be a work that cannot really have other instances because the work is precisely doing that in this particular historical event. And this is a problem for Strauss on at least these cases, maybe are marginal cases, but there seems to be work, of, especially in performances, when the performance is as a constituent essential element, some particular historical event. It's very strange. Say, yeah, you can do the same 1 year later. Yeah, but there is no longer that event because this event is an historical event, is unique. And so if this event is an essential constituent of the performance.
Yeah.
Sorry, it's just a follow-up. But if this is a problem for Strauss, why is the no reproducibility not a problem for you as well?
Yeah.
So my worry is that if this is a problem for someone, it's a problem everybody, because if the template is not reproducible, and in your account the token is the template plus something else, then even on your account the token is there can be only one token, because if the template is not reproducible, then also in your account the token is not reproducible. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah, I see, but I don't agree in the sense that for me the token is not the template plus the experience. The template is the experience full stop. So you have a plurality of tokens because you have a plurality of experiences. There are, in this event there are a plurality of spectators, each of one has its own experience, which counts as a token. So you
just the experience.
Yeah.
But then don't you have again the problem that Beto was pointing out to? That each of such tokens are going to be very different from each other. So how are you going to claim that they are actually tokens?
Yeah, because they share. If somebody, they are all abide by the prescription. In fact, if somebody is just in the same place but in a
in a basement and cannot listen to the music, it doesn't, his experience doesn't count as a token. But the others, they all have the same duration, they all receive the same stimuli, they just have different perspective on the same event.
Yeah.
And so they are different as musicians playing the same song, or singers singing the same song can have differences, but they are still constrained by some prescriptions. And so there are some relevant analogies. Sorry.
No. Thank you. And I swear it's the last one, but I mean, Strawson has a problem because some works, some tokens are meant to be exceptional. So he has this problem with unreproducible tokens. But what if a work of art is meant to be experienced just one? Don't you have the same problem? Because whatever the token is, you can always find, call it a sadistic artist who, you got the point, who has the intention that the work of art can be, for instance, experienced only once. So how can you solve this problem? Because it seems a problem for everyone, not just for Strawson.
I'm going to use in the blackboard. Remember, I like a blackboard. So, Strawson has the problem because for him, if you have a case in which, for him, the work token is something physical. So, if you have an event, somebody doing something, if this event is unique, there is no longer type token structure. You just have the token and the type collapse. You just have this guy doing something, the performance, and there is no type token. The type and the token are the same thing. In my account, even if I accept that the performance is unique, the artist is sadistic or what else, it just say, no, this is the only one, you cannot have other, you cannot do that again, the work exists only in this particular place in time. Even though I can preserve the type token structure, because each perspective on this, each experience that use this as input is a token. So the type is the prescription of the experience. This is the way in which this prescription of experience is made accessible to appreciators, and each appreciator, in watching that, in understanding that, produces its token by means of this experience. So I can avoid the collapse of the type. Of course, you cannot produce tokens after the date, but at least in this moment you have a type token structure because you have a template. The template embodies the prescription of an experience, and this guy, by abiding by the prescription, instantiates the work.
That could be just one perspective as a matter of contingency.
Why is it not?
That could be.
Okay, I see. In this case, it's very sadistic. So you say, an artist who say, my work, there is a hole in the wall, and you can just observe this by means of that. Yeah, I think that's something that I had some slide somewhere towards the end. Anyway, I like the way in which I wrote this in the slide. Yeah, that's the idea. Okay, I want to tell this on my own. So it's something somehow sympathetic with Wittgenstein's argument on private language. I think that artist is a matter of evaluation, discussion, and is something essentially intersubjective. So a work of art that can be appreciated only by one subject is not a work of art, because it doesn't make room for appreciation, evaluation in a shared way.
I have a follow-up on this, if I may.
It's problematic.
It's a bit problematic.
What about all those ideas that are very classic in analytic aesthetics about pointing out aspects of an object and, you know, teaching people how to appreciate appropriately that object as an artwork by means of paying attention to such aspects. Mm? The idea that experts can teach non-experts by means of finding the right way of pointing out to certain objects. How can this happen in your model? It's not clear to me how for instance, let's take the clearest case, the case of the virtual reality object. Mm-hmm. How can I tell another spectator, look at that particular aspect of your experience?
Yeah, because we have similar perceptor apparatuses. And therefore, we rely on the fact that even though I cannot access the experience of the other, he will have an experience similar to mine.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not like when I'm looking at a picture, you're looking at the same picture, and I can point out certain aspects of a physical object in front of us, and then hope that you'll have a singing experience similar to mine,
yeah.
And infer this from experience.
Yeah.
It seems different because there is no equivalent.
Yeah, but you can start even in novels. You can point to walls, but normally you can also do that. Say, look at this on your right. There is the lion. Look at the way in which the lion moved. Try to go towards the lion, and it's very interesting the way in which the lion tried to aggress you.
Mm.
I think you can do that by means of language. It's the way we have a way of sharing. Given the fact that we share a language and we share a perceptual system. We have ways of having intersubjective agreement and even educational insights like the one you suggested. Also in this case, of course, it's more complicated. Whereas in this case, it seems to be more problematic because there's just one person that can experience the work. And so what the meaning of this work, if nobody can discuss about this, if there is no way of arguing about its value, for me a case in which I see that it's a problem. I think that maybe this would deserve just a paper of its own, but it seems to me that I intended to say that this is not a work of art, because for me it's the possibility of the minimum of shareability. It's necessary to have a work of art. This is something can be experienced only by one person. It loses something that is crucial to art.
Yeah.
Just a different way of looking at the connection between VR and films. Suppose that you have, as it happens, so that every single scene has been pictured by two different cameras in different positions. So you have a very rich footage. And now you have these two directors who have this footage, and they decide, okay, how to order it. But they don't decide which is the specific, during the editing of the movie, they argue about which camera should be working for every scene, and the different combinations are chosen by them. The result, I would say, are two different movies with something in common. But why the same does not apply to different screenings in the case of virtual reality? So the idea is that screenings are just, works of art on their own, which are sensitive to a type token distinction, in a way. You can repeat the same screening through digital techniques. And a family of things which share the same ontological status as movies, precisely in the case of the two directors arguing with one another, and which produces, after all, different films, yes, something very important in common. Maybe you can want to go hierarchical here and say there is something called the metafilm, which is the work of art of which those two films are in a way in this relation, which I don't know, score, performance, or whatever relation you want to think of them with. But they are all abstract objects of their old types. And of course, experience may be as important as in your account, but comes in a way of a different level. So why not equating screenings, different screenings, to films in this very peculiar relation with each other, with picture?
Yeah, from a merely ontological point of view, it works. I think the reason why I would not like to do that is that we don't have practices, cultural practices, in which we evaluate screenings. We don't quantify, film critics, film historians don't quantify over screenings. So I'm Quinean in this sense. I think that the ontology of art should be interested in what art historians and art critics quantify on, just as ontology in general maybe should consider what scientists quantify on. And so it seems that, well, from an ontological level, you are right. There are all, you can find type token relation in all these cases. But I think the difference is that in practices of appreciation, evaluation, we are interested in certain objects and not in others. And so the type, for me, the work that should be created as a type is something that we refer to by means of proper names, titles of works, and we use these names in reviews, in history of art books, and so for instance, in virtual reality, people discuss about the value of this Carnegie Arena work. They don't discuss about the value of a particular screening of Carnegie Arena.
Yes, of course, but you know, you can have a general ontological templates in which, you know, screenings in one work of art corresponds to movies and works of art correspond to meta-movie, the strange entity which we discussed before. And you have this kind of ontological, you know, schema, which does not entail that in every field of art the same level is equally important. That the fact that in movie field of art films is the right place where to press appreciation, stuff like that, does not entail that the same level within a different work of art, the screenings, must be the important level. Maybe in different works of art, what is the important level for appreciation can change. Nonetheless, the whole ontological structure remains the same. No,
yeah.
I don't know.
What I would like to argue is that in all cases, what is the relevant objects in different forms of art is always something that, in order to be fully appreciated, to have all the relevant features, you should go till the experience. Because if you just stop at some physical object, you still lack something that is relevant for the appreciation. So I of course I need to maybe to argue more to persuade people about that. But I agree with this line that is the so. Consider what people, critics, spectators, or what cultural practices quantify on, so the titles of work, what one, the objects that are referred to by the titles of work, and then try to, these titles of work for me are something that has relevant features, I think we agree on that, and try to find the particular object that exhibit these relevant features. And my intuition is that you know, if you want to do that, physical object is not enough, and you should go to up to experiences.
But I have nothing to say about that.
It's helpful. Yeah.
I have one more commentary / question. I'm fascinated by your account because, as you perhaps know, I'm not very sympathetic to the view that we have to commit ourselves to the idea that artworks are objects that actually exist. I have sympathies for fictionalism. And so I think this whole proposal of focusing on experiences as tokens of works of art is actually very interesting for someone who would avoid commitment to the existence of artworks. Because yes, of course, you can formulate it in terms of type and tokens that are the experiences, but you could also say that this is such a very this is just a very useful way of describing the fact that because we are immersed in certain cultures and in certain practices, we have the ability of experiencing the stuff that there is in a very peculiar way. So all there is just other stuff. And then we say that works of art exist because we are capable of experiencing such stuff in a very peculiar way. Once we have certain instruction, we are immersed in a certain culture, etc.
Okay, I like this question. In fact, what I've been trying to do, one way of describing what I'm trying to do is to ontologize the word Walton, in fact. Walton has this idea that work of art is representational works of art, are games of, each work is a game of its own, and we have props and we can play this game. But he basically is an anti, is a fictionalist, is anti-realist. So he says, yeah, we just have the games, the prop, the work is not exactly the prop. We have that, we can play these games, but it's more within practices. And what I'm trying to do, and so it seems that what you are trying to do is to, to be more one Waltonian than I am. So you say, well, yeah, we just have practices, way of behaving, way of sharing experiences. We use physical objects, of course. I don't think that you deny the existence of canvas or sounds, but we don't, there are no particular. Ontological category, since experiences are just more on the side of the subject, and prescription also are more on the subject of intersubjectivity. So at a pure objective level, there is nothing. Is that your point?
There are no additional things that are subject, especially no creative types.
Yeah, for me, in fact, for me, creative types basically are norms. I have an idea that types are prescriptions. So, a prescription to how to construct the tokens. And so, I don't think that there are Platonic entities. So, for me, I'm a realist about works of art in the sense that I think they exist as just as laws of state exist. So, there are prescriptions, we have ways of abiding by this prescription, and that's the instantiation for me. I think that maybe there is some physicalist way of reducing prescriptions to some mental state and the patterns of mental state of brain states, and to reduce experience to other patterns of brain states. In this case, I may say, so also part of just all these brain states. But if one is not committed to physicalism, I think that we can trade also prescription norms as a part of being, and also experiences as part of being. So in this sense, I think that I take myself to be a realist on works of art, but not in the sense that they are objects in some strong sense. For me, they exist on the type side as prescription, and on the token side as experiences.
Other questions? Okay, thanks, Enrico.